Hey there, and welcome back to our PD Medications Purposes and Mechanisms series. This is going to be the final part where we talk about levodopa and carbidopa levodopa and why they're prescribed and how they help persons with Parkinson's disease. Without further ado, let's cue the intro and I'll meet you on the other side. Hit it. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. And for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. All right, so it's time for the big one. Levodopa. Levodopa was discovered and used in trials helping persons with Parkinson's disease around the late 1960s. One of the common side effects of levodopa is nausea and vomiting. So they discovered that when they combined levodopa with a chemical called carbidopa, that it significantly reduced or eliminated that issue. And that hence the reason for the combination that you see so much commonly prescribed as what we know as Sinemet. So why levodopa? Well, obviously you need dopamine if you're not producing enough dopamine. So levodopa acts to bring those dopamine levels back up again so that you can move better and that your brain is functioning better and all that. How does it work? Well, the problem that we have when we try to get chemicals into the brain is that we have this thing called the blood-brain barrier. You see, blood does not actually touch the brain tissue. It just comes right up to it, and then there's literally a barrier. It's a physical membrane barrier between the bloodstream and the brain tissue itself. And so whatever nutrients, chemicals, whatever you're trying to get into the brain, they have to pass through that barrier. And in order to do that, you have to have levodopa, because you can't just put regular dopamine in the bloodstream and it float around and it goes right into the brain. Levodopa has to cross that blood-brain barrier, and once it gets into the brain, it's then chemically transformed into dopamine. So think of levodopa as a precursor to dopamine that turns into dopamine once it gets into the brain. We could go into what the blood-brain barrier is and why it exists, but that's not really important. Just know that in order for dopamine to get into the brain, you have to have levodopa to cross that barrier. Because levodopa has been around for so long now, there's really a lot of modalities that you can use to get levodopa into your system. There's, of course, pill form, but there's also injectable forms. There's also the duopa pump, which is an interintestinal pump, essentially, is what that is. It goes right into the duodenum. And finally, you have inhalables like Inbrija, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. So you've got your Sinemet and Sinemet continued release. Those are the two common pill forms. Your enteral suspension is the duopa pump. Essentially, the idea with the pump is that you eliminate the stomach. You can get the medication directly into the intestine for maximum absorption as quickly as possible. And it's a continuous release of the chemical, so you don't have to keep taking pills all day long. Disadvantage with the duopa pump is that it's a surgical procedure and you basically have a little bit of a higher risk of infection, plus with management of that port that goes into your abdomen. But it can be life-altering in a positive way for many, many people that have had it done. In contrast to continued release Sinemet, you also have extended release capsules of carbidopa levodopa, and that's called Retari. We talked about Stalevo in a previous video where we covered COMT inhibitors, but Stalevo is a combination of carbidopa levodopa and COMT inhibitor entacapone. Finally, there's the inhaled powder or Inbrija. Essentially, Inbrija is like a rescue inhaler for persons with Parkinson's disease. There are times when you're just going to have symptoms break through, especially if you've had Parkinson's disease for many years, even multiple decades in some cases. Those with young onset Parkinson's disease tend to have those more breakthrough symptoms because you're taking very frequent doses of carbidopa levodopa and your off times may happen much more often, and they can be more severe where even when you're on a dose of medication, you can have a breakthrough of motor symptoms whether it's dyskinesia, dystonia, convulsive movements, and so forth, freezing episodes, you name it. So Inbrija essentially can be taken by somebody in those moments of breakthrough symptoms, and it's about, I've actually seen this work before my very eyes with a client I work with. It's like instantaneous doses of dopamine in your system, and those symptoms just disappear practically. So pretty amazing stuff. Common side effects, as mentioned previously, are nausea and vomiting. That can be mitigated by not taking it on an empty stomach or not a completely empty stomach. We'll talk a little bit more about that briefly in just a moment. You can have loss of appetite with carbidopa, levodopa. In addition, you can have lightheadedness, lowered blood pressure, confusion and hallucinations, which we talked about before. It's pretty much a common side effect with every Parkinson's med. You can have dyskinesias, as we mentioned in previous videos, where you have higher doses of dopamine, you tend to have more uncontrolled movements. It's kind of a catch-22. You move better, you get these uncontrollable movements. You can't win them all. But then there are medications we talked about in previous episodes where you can help with that dyskinesia. Sleepiness can be common, or just kind of a generic, kind of a tiredness or fatigue can set in. Sudden onset of sleep is not common with carbidopa levodopa, as it is with some of the dopamine agonists. Finally, impulsivity is possible, even though that's also uncommon. So briefly mentioned something about eating and timing of medications, and I'm not going to go into that detail because I talked about protein and levodopa absorption in a previous video I'll link up here. But really, any protein in particular can interfere with the absorption of levodopa. But also your timing of meds is really important with carbidopa, levodopa. If you take your meds completely on an empty stomach, you can get nausea and vomiting. But what you can do is have a very small light snack before taking your medication. For example, applesauce, a graham cracker, some tea or soup. Something that's going to just give a little bit of an insulation of your stomach wall before you take your medication. It can be broken down and absorbed after the stomach empties. But generally speaking, you want to take carbidopa, levodopa, or levodopa on its own 30 minutes prior to eating, or at least an hour following a meal, so that you have the most absorption possible. Otherwise, it's going to sit there in the stomach until the stomach empties if you've already eaten, and that could take at least an hour. And if you have Parkinson's disease, you can have problems with emptying the stomach in a timely manner. You can have slowing of the entire system because of reduced peristalsis. You can also have gastroparesis, where the stomach really isn't contracting much, if at all. So it's really important to take your meds before eating if possible, or waiting that longer period of time after eating to make sure that as soon as you take your medication, it's essentially leaving the stomach. Well, that's going to conclude our series on Parkinson's medications. We could, of course, cover a ton if we did a video on supplements and alternative and complementary treatments. We're probably not going to do that yet, but let me know if you'd like to see something like that. But until then, I'm going to conclude this series, and I really hope you've enjoyed it. I would love to hear your feedback. Thanks, as always, for watching. Until the next episode of the podcast, take care of yourself, be empowered, and keep up the good fight.